do you feel like your team is perhaps under attack? Well, our next speaker is going to be addressing this topic. If you look at her background, certainly is going to provide an interesting perspective that you may have talent in your organization. You've worked hard to get that talent, but is someone looking to pull them out because of that talent and how difficult it is to find that talent? Let's give our attention to Deidre Diamond from CyberSN. And that's, she certainly understands the space and can talk to us about this. Deidre.
Good afternoon. How's everybody doing? I'm closing, so we're gonna raise the energy up a little. We don't have to get up and stretch, but definitely I've got a half hour for you all and an action-packed half hour to wrap this day up. First of all, serious applause to RSA for bringing an entire day about management and diversity and inclusion. RSA continues to impress me. They were the first to call out the problem with dressing women scandalously and putting them at booths and vendors, right? Booth faves. They're super progressive, and so I want to thank them and call them out at helping us better our community. The human side of what we do is what I'm super passionate about, and this title was a cute way to get in front of everybody as well to talk about these three things, or at least this is what you're going to learn. And so it's really important to understand my story. So for a few minutes, let me tell you, I'm a social criminal justice major and born in Southern California, went to school at Cal State Fullerton. And when I graduated, I thought I was going to be a criminal attorney, and my internships really turned me off to that. And I answered a little ad in the paper that said, "Can you think on your feet?" And I ended up working for those people for 21 years across three different companies. And they brought me into a story that was really about training and developing people and building companies and building empires, actually. One of those companies is Rapid7. I was the first VP of sales there. Prior to that, 13 years of technical staffing. And so as you can see, I've put the two together to build what is today the largest cybersecurity solely focused staffing firm in the United States with an international job platform. So from that, I've been watching what's going on. I'm super curious about society in general and why humans do what they do. But when it comes to jobs, there's nothing more emotional and important because it's how we really feed ourselves and take care of ourselves and our loved ones. And so these are the three things I'm going to make sure that you leave learning today, even though we've got 30 minutes. I can do it. This is my quote here on the left, which is to let you all know that we are in the era of emotional intelligence. We are also in the era of a talent war. We certainly have heard all day long about the different types of people we need to be able to bring in and call talent, and that is absolutely true. And then there's the here and now and what's happening with all of you in your roles today with experience and your leadership, and certainly that's what I'm focusing on today. I've been watching this marketplace now for 5.5 years and what's happening, and it's quite disturbing, and which is why I came out to talk and really share the things that I learned about building organizations such that I can help all of us really change the game. And so right now, this is the real quote that's out there, 62%. So for all of us who are really feeling the pain of not being able to acquire talent, I really encourage you to start with how you're going to retain talent. And certainly when my firm is hired to service and 75% of what we do is hands-on technical cyber roles, we really sit down and talk about your retention plan. Because if I'm going to unleash my team to the universe to go find you people, I need to know that you've got a story I can sell. And that story better be better than the story they have. And so we really need to understand, why are people leaving their jobs? You can look at it as recruiters infiltrating or, you know, stealing your people, or you can look at it as we all want the same things. And so therefore, if somebody's going to leave your company, they're most likely leaving for a reason that you're not paying attention to. And there are some circumstances where it makes sense, but most, 62%, just wanting an environment that was more nurturing. And so here's what EQ is. Here's the definition of it. It is, luckily, it has breached into the capital marketplace, meaning some of the studies that we've heard about, some of the things that we've all heard about today. We now understand how much value there is to quote talent, which is what we all are. And so meaning the stock market is paying attention to leaders, managers who have high EQ. It's what everybody's looking for. What does that mean? You can work with teams. You can stay calm, cool, and collected when stuff hits the fan. And it hits the fan every day. Like literally every day from the perspective of breakdown of communication. Never mind what most of you are dealing with in terms of attacks and defending yourselves and us and everybody. And so imagine, you know, if we weren't able to stay calm, cool, and collected. Or think about the people that don't stay calm, cool, and collected that you work with. Not fun, not interesting, and certainly not going to retain talent when there's other people who can offer something different. And just because job searching is broken and the system is completely wrecked from any sort of really empowering us all as individuals with opportunity choice is not an excuse to run a culture that isn't high EQ. And so I encourage you, there's training you can get for yourselves and for your teammates, emotional intelligence training, some we used to call it soft skills training. Not a lot of people liked that, especially engineers. It's okay, but it's time to like it, you know? Geek is chic. And what does that mean? You know, that term, geek is chic, means you're now expected to speak as good as salespeople. Now, good salespeople. Okay, not the best, right? So really those skills are out there to be had, and you really want to find them. And so let's talk specifically about why people are leaving in cybersecurity. Like, let's just narrow this down. This, you know, the majority of what we'll talk about could apply to any human, but let's really bring this into cybersecurity. Here's the stats. These are the stats you'll find, ISC squared, ISSA, any stat you find, and I'll tell you, from my database and what I see every day, this is exactly what's going on. So a third are leaving because there's no investment in their career, no training. No, this is where you're going to go next. Here's our plan for you. That's a third of why people leave, for sure. Number two, a third. Company doesn't take security seriously. We've seen this. In fact, chief security officers struggle with this the most because they're sold that they can come in and build teams and you know, really invest in security. But the reality is compliance is winning in terms of budgets and in terms of money. And so what, I mean, just this, I've been here no less than 48 hours, although half my operation's here, and so I'm here most of the time. But I wasn't here 48 hours where two CISOs that I know took jobs in the last year, and they're literally looking again, and they've been looking for a few months, and it's all because nobody cares about anything other than compliance. And so that's what that means. And that shows up in if there's no training dollars. That shows up in if there's no succession planning. That shows up in if you're not willing to support the needs of security versus compliance. And most professionals aren't interested in just compliance. It's boring. Your mind goes numb. I know. Mine would too. You're in security. You want to protect, not play the legal game of the stock market only. So it's super important to recognize that. And then a third, disrespectful work environment. So I think the first two are disrespectful to humans. But if we want to say, okay, what's that mean then? That's just how we talk to each other. That's literally language and behavior of how we interact with each other. And the fact that that's still happening, and we want diversity to come into that. I mean, you know, what that says is fighting, a lot of upset, a lot of people getting upset. And I'll tell you, language is the number one thing. I keynoted at Hacker Halter like 4 years ago, and it was the best ever experience. And so I want to share this with you, what I mean by language. There's five words that I give a talk on to eliminate from your vocabulary. One of them is the word but. It's causing the most havoc in employment and relationships at work that ever could exist. So I talked about why we want to eliminate but. Because if I said, I really liked your presentation and all the work you did on that project, but what happened to the piece about, you know, HR, blah, blah, blah? Then I didn't really like your work because I didn't actually stop talking and let it pause, and the button negates it. So anyhow, this man raised his hand and said, oh my gosh, one of my fellow engineers literally shared an email with me today where he gave notice, and it was, the first paragraph was how much they love him and respect him, and then it was the word but, dot, dot, dot. here's why we can't do what you want. Here's why we can't give you what you want. And it really is that simple, right? In terms of like thinking about the words that we use such that it doesn't mean that that company shouldn't have been able to give him what he wanted. It's the layup that was terrible, right? Terrible. So never mind email, but the word but in between, there's but. So if we put these all together, who's happy? Like, who's happy? It's ridiculous. It's why, for me, I'm super passionate about helping people build work cultures that they can love working out. Now, most of my clients, can do that for periods of time. And as we all know, capitalism comes in and all this change happens and then they start, it's just heartbreaking. But for those of us that really want to change these statistics, we can. We definitely can. And, if we don't, we're gonna lose this defense war, for sure. Because the amount of distraction that is going on, if a chief information security officer is leaving their job every 18 months, and my data is United States, by the way, and it's commercial, not government. I don't service the government today. So in 18 months is the typical time a CISO leaves job, what is getting done? How are we progressing? What happens to the people under them? Like, the amount of happiness is low, and yet these jobs, the things you all do, the things we're all doing together that are in this industry, is the most important thing we could be doing today. Because it's all about protecting. And so it's really disheartening to think about these statistics that I have up here. And so nobody's going to change it other than us. And the way that you're going to change it is by voting with your feet. So we're short 500,000 people in the United States, so don't work anywhere that doesn't treat you correctly, period. And I know job searching is terrible, and there's a broken system. I built something to solve it. We just launched. Check it out. It's going to take a little time. But my point is, it's terrible. We can't match. Nobody who speaks cybersecurity in recruiting. I had to build job building technology. I had to build interviewing technology, which is now my SaaS job platform, so that my recruiters could be cost effective and so that we could speak the language. So you've got that on top of all of these things. And so we just got this crazy, people moving around system that we're distracted by and hindered by. So a lot of people ask me, how do we do what we do? So here's the secret sauce, if you will, but it's really not a secret. I'm a human too, and I have the same vulnerabilities as everybody else. And so if my vulnerabilities are open, then I should be talking to a recruiter, meaning if I'm not fulfilled, I should be. And so people don't talk to recruiters when they're fulfilled. They don't have time. They're focused. They're committed. They just don't. And yet, recruiters can be skilled and good at what they do. So just know that everything I'm talking about today is great recruiters. When I became a recruiter in January of 94, I learned that recruiters had just as bad of a reputation as attorneys. And good thing I wasn't an attorney. It's like I landed in the same thing. And yet, just like a great attorney, if you have a great attorney, it's the best thing you can have if you need one, right? And so I feel that way about recruiting and certainly my team and who we all are. It really comes from putting ourselves in your shoes. And hoping you do the same for us. So when I talk about what we're doing, just know that I'm talking about great recruiters. So think about it. We're doing recon first. Our ears are on the marketplace. We divide up based on states and in some regions, cities. And recruiters are responsible for the ears on the street looking for this kind of data. This is low-hanging fruit, right? If I've got the whole United States to source from, I want to source from the lowest hanging fruit, the place where the vulnerabilities are going to be most obvious. When these things that on this board happen is where vulnerabilities are most open. And so a skilled recruiter will listen to the marketplace and they will also listen to you all. So imagine, a good recruiter is talking to you all day long. That data, as my chief security officer calls our data, the Ashley Madison of databases. It was fascinating when I heard that. I was like, oh, great. And yet, thank you, because that's how much it needs to be protected. Meaning I have that data. What you all think of your employers. What you think of who you work for. Because you're not talking to us if you've got the things that you need. And so you're sharing what you're not getting from where you're at so that we can find what you need. And so great recruiters are really processing and putting that data searchable, if you will, but right away implemented. Meaning if we hear rumors and we hear things, it's fascinating, before most, about all of these things. Who are our friends? Again, speaking for CyberSN, software security salespeople, they're my friends. I built 100 of them, including sales engineering, before I left Rapid 7, right? Who are our friends? So we're talking to these people. We're staying in tune. What's happening with you all? How can we help you? You can look at it as, Google-ish, or you can look at it as, there's no other way to help than to be this in tune. Because if I'm going to encourage you or talk to you about an opportunity to go somewhere else, I need to know it's a better place. And how the heck can I know if I don't know what's missing for you? Right? So interesting stuff. And yet, again, it wasn't until my chief security officer, who's been with me almost 5 years now, said to me, you're one of the best social engineers. I hadn't even thought of that. So what is social engineering then to get the information you need to do whatever you want to do? Well, I want to help. I want to win-win. And I need that kind of information. And I suppose it's social engineering. All right. Of course, we're using LinkedIn. Now, my estimates and what I can tell based on having 1,000 recruiting licenses in LinkedIn and, doing the work that I do, there's about 35% of us that are considered cyber professionals on LinkedIn. I certainly know my real technical folks on my cyber team have taught me that they have a profile that they park so that their identity is not stolen, but they're not looking at that, whatever email they put to that thing, and they're certainly not paying attention. And so 35% is what I see. It's definitely more of a CISO leadership people on there because they need to be in order to find jobs and network, if you will. And yet, whatever's there, we're certainly looking at. And it's a great way to say our own analysis of this person's probably not happy. Their title hasn't changed in 3 years. Their work experience hasn't changed. They haven't gotten any new certs, no new degrees. And imagine, I'm working with companies that for sure are doing those things, or I'm not working with them, right? Training programs, succession planning, right? All of those things. So we're looking for that turnover, right? What does LinkedIn tell us every day? Who took a job where, right? Every day. Even if you turn off, don't tell the world that I just took a job, recruiter licenses can tell us things, right? They're really expensive. And yet they have that information. So, again, knowledge is power. I'm sharing all of this with you all so that you can understand how in tune you really need to be. And, I'm going to go through this a little bit quickly because I wanted to get into some other stuff, but just recognize that when you hear, I think of a hot job, this might sound look cheesy, but truly, what's a hot job? Is a place that somebody's going to be taken care of. People want to invest in them. People know their roles and responsibilities. Now, again, most of the time I have to coach to be there, but that's okay. As long as they're willing to be coached and we get there, it's cool. But willing to have succession planning, knowing where we're going, what's the plan, what's the strategy in detail. But, really, truly, we're talking about these things. Like any client, if I'm onboarding, they're checking this box, every box. And if they can't check the box and they're willing to check the box and work with us to check the box, then great. If not, call us when you're ready to check these boxes. Because I'm not going out to a marketplace where we're short 500,000, where everybody's employed, with experience, again, they're paying for this service, and sell anything other than all of these things, because chances are they're only missing a few of these things. And if we're going to do this, then let's make sure that we're putting our best foot forward. And we're literally talking about these things. And love is like literally, it's funny, I'll never forget the day I was in a leadership meeting about 10 years ago, and what do we want Rapid7 to be about? And or maybe it was 15 years ago. And myself and some of the other founders, founding folks said, love. And everyone's like, what? You know? And it really, truly, what that means is that people love where they're working. You know, like they look forward to getting up in the morning. We talk about burnout as if it's a responsibility of one individual human. It's actually the responsibility of the organization, and we're going to get to that right now. Because really what this is about is preventing the loss of talent. And we started there, and this is something I rolled out last year at RSA, and I call it the human hygiene model. You know, we all have all these technical hygiene models, and certainly now that's branched into finance and marketing and what have you. Well, we really need to bring it into management. I said earlier that management is responsible. And I really think it's important that we talk about what management is. Management means that somebody reports to you. If somebody reports to you, you are responsible for their success. And sometimes people will fail. By far, if you're really taking that seriously, most people will succeed. And you will make some mistakes and you will learn. But if somebody works for you, I had first person work for me when I was 22 years old. And by the end of that year, it was 40 people. And it hasn't stopped since. And I was told that nobody comes to work to fail, Deidre, so get it together, because the first person that worked for me was really just, you know, I was having a tough time with him listening to me. And my mentor, which is was many people at the time, but those two serial entrepreneurs, many people that were also working there, said, nobody comes to work to fail. You know, so as a manager, and I think we really get lost in this leadership management, who's responsible? You know, and who's on first in terms of making decisions about other people? Well, as far as I can see, I've seen tons of people be called leaders and not responsible for people. And that's great. In fact, in my company, I tell the most entry-level person, you're in leadership. This whole company's in leadership. We are leaders. You're going to learn how to be a greater, bigger, you know, more profound leader. But you're a leader the minute you're here. And management is if you want to be responsible for others. And you really have got the passion to take on building teams and caring for humans. And yes, you're going to have some sort of SME core skill you bring to that from your past. And yet, your number one responsibility is to care for those people. So within management, I say to folks, have a human hygiene model, meaning think about us all as humans and that we all want the same things. We all want to make as much money as we can. We all want to, you know, be as happy as we can. We all want to be trained and learning and achieving and growing. We all want to work with kindful, respectful people, right? We all want to feel secure and have mental safety such that we can speak. Those environments can't exist. I know. I've worked in them. Still do. And yet, it's the responsibility of the manager to create them. And so we must say, okay, so how do we teach them? What's the, you know, so that's why I wanted to give you this model. And what it really starts with is to identify, and I this is an hour talk, so I'm going to do short with just this slide. And I see signs of time going up. Where am I? Oh, really? I was going to say, he showed me 20, it's 10. Okay. So this first thing is about identifying, meaning the most important thing in terms of your framework to do is to make sure you understand everybody's role and responsibility that works for you, and that everybody on the team understands everybody else's roles and responsibility. That is not a job description that you posted that said, I want you to do security engineering, and I want you 5 years of this and 3 years. That's not your role and responsibility, right? So you really have to take it down to the task and project level, how much time somebody spends on each of these tasks and projects. If you look at the jobs posted on my website, you'll see that I built a technology that does this. You can use it for free, literally. But my point is, you have to talk about tasks and projects. You have to be able to let people understand everybody's roles and responsibilities. And then you need to have a backup plan. Because we are all human, things will go on. People have life tragedies, life situations that happen. You might lose somebody over that. You might lose somebody because you weren't paying attention. You might lose somebody because just a better opportunity actually came, and it's probably good that they go, for them, not for you. You may lose people for a variety of reasons, and therefore you must plan for it. Don't assume you're not. So what does that mean? You got to be plugged into systems that can get you, you know, folks. Those are programs of, like you've heard today, folks like myself, a place where you can go and get help fast. Because sitting and waiting to fill your roles means you're about to lose more. When people say they don't take security seriously, leaving open roles unfilled is one of the biggest signs. It means you're not willing to invest. And I can tell you something that will blow your socks off. I mean, you'll understand, not because it's rare, but it's crazy to me. So I have an arm that places sales software folks in security only. Don't touch anything under security. That arm, HR, will pay us a fee within 10 seconds of that role being open. In cybersecurity, it's a minimum of 6 months until an organization understands, you know, how to, you know, and finds us and then is willing to even invest. Some of my favorite clients still can't get the, you know, the next rec pushed through to use us again until 6 months after it's posted again. So what's happening is the folks that are working there are overworked. So yes, there's a shortage, but if all of those people are unhappy, a third, a third, and a third, you can find talent if you're willing to invest in a resource, resources like myself, my teams, to find them. And when you don't, you're sending a message that you really don't care. And this is what's happening certainly to the CISOs on a daily basis. And even, of course, all of us, as we're doing the work, or you all, that is not getting done. And so it's complicated. The budgets, you know, haven't really caught up to security like they did in IT software. And, you know, my 13 years of recruiting prior to doing Rapid7 and getting into software sales, you know, people use recruiters for IT and software roles all day long. But in cyber, it's super rare. Isn't that crazy? Why? The money hasn't yet been committed. And even though a lot of people are saying they're going to hire these people, they're not. And I'm here to tell you that if you want to, you can. And that's what I want to encourage all of you who are super passionate about your role and your company and where you work right now. And if you want to, you can. So have a backup plan. Know where to go. Know how to find resources that can help you so that you don't have to burn out somebody or multiple somebodies. And then you're just going to be spinning your wheels, you know? And then you're going to go to contract or to an MSP, and then you're going to go out and in and right? Oh, my Lord. So, you know, it's like, let's just call it something else. And really, it's just, you know, hiring humans. So and then you got to monitor. This means you have to care about how the people that work for you feel, think, perceive. You actually have to be thinking about those things and paying attention to their body language, their verbal language, their written language. Like, you have to monitor, pay attention. How is the health of my folks on a regular basis? Somebody walks differently. I'm like, oh, what's going on? You know, like, seriously, I'm that in tune. Super in tune. It's really important. My job is to care. How the heck do I care if I'm not in tune? My job is also to care from the perspective of a strategy and make sure everybody doesn't have to worry and can move forward and all those things. I'm willing to play that role. Are you? You know, and if you are, make sure you've got a plan like this to do that. And then update. This is the investment in the human, right? And all of us want that investment, meaning make sure that we are providing training, providing the support. And again, if EQ is wanted more today in the capital markets than IQ, then what training are you giving for that? I have a few that ISC Squared certifies, but there's a lot more out there too. Situational leadership. A lot of transformational mind dynamic, Myers-Briggs are good ways to start, at least getting in the game of thinking, things that you can even take off of line like Myers-Briggs, just to get your teams and yourselves thinking about how others think, feel, and perceive, because that's the name of the game. It's totally the name of the game. We are in a service era, and it's a service era in terms of jobs, even though you're technical, it's the service area. This is the time of today. And it's also the time of transparency and individualism, which means each human has really got to take on their own getting what they need. And we've got a broken job system, so it means you're going to have to work at it. And you have to put some effort into it. And coming here in places like this is a great thing to do because you can network and meet folks. So on that note, we've got a few minutes left. I see five here, and I always love to engage folks. So whether it be questions or comments, I'd love to hear from you. Anybody? How many people here are hiring right now? Good, good. So retention first, yeah? Have your story down. And also make sure that your interviewing process makes sense. I can't tell you how many times somebody goes to sit with somebody that is a part of your interviewing process and they're quizzing them on things that don't have anything to do with the job and it just totally throws the person off, or they're not engaging that person in a way that even shows they care. And you're done, it's over, they're not gonna come back. Nobody's desperate. So prepare. Yes. Hi.
Hi. Hey. What is your favorite interview question to assess someone's EQ?
Oh, wow. I've never been asked that. You know, so to me, it's not one question. If I'm in an interview and I'm assessing EQ, it's the entire process with that person. And I would encourage that of you too. We are humans. And that's what I started off in my first slide to say. There's no way we're not vulnerable. Somebody could have a bad day. I mean, what's our divorce rate? It's ridiculous, which means conflict in our personal lives is happening. You got children, right? You don't know what's happening. It's nerve-wracking, just maybe being late, plus all of those things. So you gotta take your time to assess EQ in the interview process. That being said, it's really, do you have people that would, you know, that worked for you before? If you're interviewing for a management position, I'm talking to those people. Because if those people don't exist, right? It doesn't mean maybe I wouldn't hire that person. I would really talk to that person about needing to recalibrate maybe their skill set or what have you. I go pretty deep. That's a great question. That is a great question. You know, I have this EQ tree that's in my offices. I do talk about it a lot. It's one of my talks, favorite talks, and it's something I'll publish. And by the way, if you would like my slides from today, just text RSAC 2020 33777, 33777. So, and you can get all of our slides today, and I can include the EQ tree. But lean language, win-win communication skills, making and managing agreements, measurable agreements, excuse me, which is the most important word in there, you know, like if we're making agreements and they're not measurable, well, chaos is just gonna happen when it comes down to due time. And it's going to be political, and who gets to point fingers wins in terms of who's got more political power. And so, you know, the point is, you know, EQ skills actually are those skills. It's not just having empathy and the willingness to listen and compassion. It's literally the skill of how to make an agreement, how to measure that agreement, and then remake it if you know it's going to change. Win-win communication, things like that, too. Yes. Hi.
Hi, Deidre. My question has to do with the culture that you're talking about in terms of talent retention. And I guess I'm curious in your experience, how much does an individual manager, how much influence do they have on the retention of employees if the culture tone at the top is kind of busted?
That's such a great question. A ton more. You're working with that person every day. They're in charge of your life in terms of success, excuse me, your career life, how they treat you, how they talk about you up, how they review you determines how much money you make, never mind whether or not you get to move forward in your career. So it matters a ton, so much so that organizations are actually, again, progressive ones, are actually moving to group cultures. Instead of saying our company culture is X, we're allowing groups to have their own culture. Now, I think, you know, there's one culture we all want, so it's a little bit crazy. Why don't we just have the one that we all want? And yet, if it works, it works. And so people leave people For sure. They don't necessarily leave companies. And that being said, there are plenty of wonderful managers who find themselves stuck because they're not being supported above them, right? And so that's when things can get tricky. And, you know, it's all about transparency and honesty, because at the end of the day, you know, if humans, if somebody believes, you know, you believe in me and you care, and we know we're trying to figure some things out, I'm not going to just go want to hook up with new people tomorrow. You're like, that's not fun. You know, just thinking about like going finding new people to work with, it's not like super exciting, because we all know what that experience is like and how long it takes to create a relationship and how long you can trust, you know, until you can trust and count on and can you even and all that. So if I've got a really great manager and that person's sharing with me that haven't yet figured out how to grow you past right this second or right now or 6 months from now or a year from now, and I'm talking about those things, I'm going to stick around most likely and see if we can't figure it out, you know? So it's super important. And it's also super important for that person to get supported. Yeah. I see that we're out of time, but go ahead. We're the last ones.
Question two. So yeah. Question for you on terms of counteroffers and your opinion around that. Mm. So as you're recruiting and you've got those six or seven missing components, they may be missing money, maybe they're missing growth, and they share that with you, the hiring manager or the manager of the departing, that I'm leaving and this is why. What's your opinion on counteroffers?
Yeah, so it's a tricky one, because I just counteroffered not too long ago somebody that's important to me, and I just didn't see the sign. Very junior person. I still hold myself accountable, and I believe that there's circumstances where that ought to be. And yet most of what I see is that the counteroffer is so that the company has time to replace the person. And or when things do get difficult down the road, that person is possibly the person that, you know, is deemed not as committed, if you will. If we're looking for an excuse in the board or in the executive room or the whatever room of sort of cutting costs, it's very possible. And yet, you know, I tell everybody, you got to go with your gut. You know, don't go with data. When it comes to this, our jobs, you know, our livelihoods, you got to go with your gut. If you've been working for these people for a long time, like this woman was for me for 3 years, and I didn't catch that her manager didn't have what he needed to have to be able to really own that, you know, then that's great. And if you're really willing to own up on that. But let me tell you something. Owning up on money is not, like, it wasn't money, right? It was treatment of and being heard and all of those things. And so, you know, it's hard to really say, oh, sorry about the money, you know? It is hard, meaning like to be genuine, you know? So it's really something that we all have to go with our own gut. And we all have to trust our guts. Like, your gut is actually right. In my opinion, I see that people's guts are usually exactly the right answer, meaning they're happy about their decision. It's really when we go against our gut, like the airport line. I'm constantly going, my gut says that line, but for whatever reason, my body walks over here. You know, it's so weird. And then literally that's the line, you know? So I'm super trained with my life to go with my gut in terms of big stuff or the small stuff. And so I catch how that happens. So I really appreciate you all coming and listening and participating. And again, my slides can be sent to you all at any time at rsec2020 to text 33777, cybersn.com. Find me. I'm always around. I'm talking twice more this week. So if you're interested in some other topics, love to see you there. Have a great day. Or night.